Susi, it's so nice to meet you, and thank you for letting me take the time to ask you questions and just to get to know you more. And so I want to start with just asking you, what were you like as a teenager?
I was really quiet. I was raised in Vernal, Utah, which is an all-white community. Mm-hmm. My parents were all white as well, my whole family. So I was really struggling to figure out who I was and where I fit in this world ethnically. So I was really quiet. I was a follower. I really just wanted people to like me. Lack of self-confidence. I think a lot of teenagers may feel that way.
And that's the same with me. Like, growing up, I've always wanted to, like, I depended on what other people were thinking. Mm-hmm. And so, like, before I did anything, I would be like, in my head, I'm just like, oh, what if they think this, somebody think that? So I would back off on what, on my own opinions and, like, what I want to do. So I'm the same way as you as a teenager. When did you first decide to become politically active?
I get this question a lot. I don't actually look at myself as politically active, but I have been always fighting for the underdog. And I don't think fighting, but always wondering. I was really curious. Why don't they have food? What's this country we live in? Why isn't somebody helping them? And so I think my curiosity helped me find those different passions and then dive into it and figure it out for myself. You know, you start, and I think that that's politically active. A lot of people call it that way. I would say that I'm very curious. And then I would say that I'm brave and courageous to stand up to say this isn't right, even if I have to stand by myself often. At least that's my opinion.
I really like that, because, like, I'm born in Egypt, but I moved down here. Mm-hmm. And I think my community, we're really there to help each other. And, like, we're really there to, like, uplift each other. And, like, we're there for each other and everything. And, like, we have something called Sunduk, which is where everybody in the community puts money together and it goes to one specific mm-hmm. person. And it's a new person every month, I think. And so we're there to, like, make sure someone is getting money. And, like, anytime someone in the community dies, like, we are there to help them. We are there to, like, support them. And, like, even for, like, weddings or anything, we're there to support. We're there to, like, give that money for them that they need and just to be able to be there.
Yeah, and you know, in modern, like, our, I think all immigrant countries, people that come from poor countries, we have our own methods of providing money for each other, right, to support mm-hmm. each other. I found that they call that in America giving circles. It's the same concept, right? That's why I say our ancestors are smart. They knew how to take care. I always say that my ancestors navigated oceans, and now my job is to navigate systems. And so all of, like, your generation that it's here is being able to take those old school values and strengths. Because remember, you didn't come to this country without strengths. Mm-hmm. Often, I think immigrants feel like they came to these shores without anything and that they had to adapt to the American way. And I'd say that we all came here with strengths mm-hmm. from our ancestors, from our countries, to build on and add to. And maybe that comes from the Hispanic community, and maybe that comes from the Asian community. But we look for those positives and add to our positives in our culture, because not everything in our culture, as you already know, is not positive, right? So we need to take the positive and leave the rest, look around us in this country that we're here for the opportunities, and take what's good and learn from the African-American community, from the Asian community, and all of those that are around us. That's what being American to me is about.
You've been involved in a lot of advocacy work for the arts, domestic violence, and Pacific Islanders. Can you talk about your work with these groups?
Yeah, all of them have been about empowering people. I felt like, first of all, domestic violence was, I'm a survivor of domestic violence and sexual assault. And moving back to Salt Lake City 30 years ago, I realized that there weren't any culturally relevant services for us. In 30 years, where my domestic violence journey started, how could that be, right? Mm. Again, being curious to say, how could that be? And getting in and saying, not only did I need services coming back to Salt Lake City, where my first abuser lived, I needed a support group, but mm-hmm. I needed it to be culturally relevant. And so started our own, because that's what I needed, and started researching and asking other women in my community, you know, do you know anyone that's a victim of domestic violence? Mm-hmm. Do you know what it is? And I would say out of need. The arts were something that I got involved in because I didn't like the negative stereotype that Pacific Islanders had here in Salt Lake. They say really negative things, and I didn't see myself as being any of those things.
Do you have some advice for how young people and young women of color can get involved in politics and change their communities for the better?
First of all, you have to know you. Where is your passion? Knowing your own biases, looking at yourself in the mirror. And then building authentic relationships is key. Those school teachers and the people that are around you. And being brave to be courageous to ask the questions. And then there's nothing wrong. I'll tell you, there is nothing greater for somebody to have, like in this case, to be called and said, hey, can you let somebody interview you? Mm-hmm. That just sounds like, wow, I would love to do that. Most mentors and most people that are working in this world are always gonna try to fit you in. So people always say, I'm so scared to call them and ask them. He said, you don't know unless you try.
I really wanna be that mentor for like the younger community. And me being a senior, I'm really close friends with the freshmen. Like I really wanna be there for them and help guide them through their high school experience because I'm not gonna be there for them next year. So like just being able to like give them the confidence to be that student and just have them like be out there, like be who you are. I really love doing that. And like those are my freshman besties. That's why I call them, like you guys are my besties. And I'm in a lot of clubs. I get really involved in the school. And like a lot of people get shocked that I'm really involved because then they ask like, how do you have time for everything? And that's what I tell them, like if you make the time, you can really be there for everything. And that's what I really try to do. And I also like went back to my old school to be an assistant coach. And like I made the time to be there and also like made the time to be at my own sports and made the time to be at my own clubs. And I really want to show them that you can really be out there in the community while also having time for yourself. And it's just like, it's a really nice thing to do.
I think it's a great example already of building relationships, right? You're already building relationships with the younger, with the freshmen. You also said that your passion, you make time. And that's exactly what happens as you get older and as your network grows, is that finding that North Star, you're starting to find that mm-hmm. already. And that's exactly what will continue to grow in your life.
And then what do you hope to accomplish for your communities?
You know, I feel like, you know, we all belong to many communities, right?
Yeah.
We probably belong to 10 or 15 different communities. I would say for every community is that every single person is empowered to prosper, whatever. Because, you know, God created us all uniquely. So that means that we uniquely need different things. Mm-hmm. And so my hope is that everyone in my communities know where to find the resources that they need to empower themselves, to take care of themselves with mental health, with physical, with spiritual, in having a balanced life. It's not about what I can do for them, but what they can do for themselves, and hopefully setting up a foundation and a structure where resources are culturally relevant so that everyone can help themselves. Right? Because mm-hmm. what I saw when I came to Utah was it seemed like everybody jumps in one box, and if you fit the box, then you can get help. Mm-hmm. But not often do we speak the same language, even if we speak English, and that everybody is at a different level of learning. So that means the resources also need to be that way, because we want everyone to find their North Star and to find the resources that they need that fit with them to empower themselves. Again, to prosper in this country and not wait for a government handout, not mm-hmm. wait for something. We are proud and people of courage and strength, and we can do, I mean, everybody is, and it's just not communities of color. Every single person in this country has the ability to help themselves. Now, our job is to help get those culturally relevant resources to available mm-hmm. and access so that everyone has equal access to what they need in their lives to prosper.
Thank you, Susi, for being here and letting me, you know, get to know you and get to know your life. And thank you for, you know, being out there for the community and being out there to have the resources for everybody. And that's really a good thing to do and an amazing thing to be able to do for your community.
Thank you for having me.